all alone. Good morning, everybody. Well, afternoon, actually. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be with you today and to talk about new resources that have been released for parents in particular, but others within the school divisions. Obviously, this is the first day back for teachers and others in our classrooms as they prepare for the return of students on Tuesday, after the long weekend. And I know that there's a lot of anticipation about the September 8th start date, but there's also a lot of anxiousness. And while anticipation and anxiousness is not new to the start of school, those are probably hallmarks of every school year, this is obviously different. It isn't the same. And that's true for myself as well as a parent. For my wife and I, we know that it's a different school year for our son, but we are excited that he's going to be back in class on Tuesday, but also anxious for the differences that are coming with it. And across Manitoba and really across Canada, when I talk to other education ministers or watching some of your news broadcasts, we certainly see that there is that anxiousness. And to the best of our ability in terms of providing answers in advance of those questions, we hope that that will alleviate some of the anxiousness. Information, of course, is power, and whenever you can provide that information, you're helping parents and others who are working in the system. So now on our education website, edu.gov.mb.ca, there are now a series of resources that are provided, I think, in a easy-to-digest format for parents and others to get some of the answers that they need. There will still, of course, be questions and interactions with individual schools and school divisions, as there is every year between parents and others in the education system. But I think that these resources are very helpful, and hopefully parents now have a few days to review them, and to the extent they didn't have some of their questions answered before, hopefully this allows them to get some of those questions answered. So again, I want to say to all those teachers and others who are back to school today, in terms of preparation, the work that you're doing now today in preparation is incredibly important work for next Tuesday. Not easy work, not work that you might have anticipated a year ago, but incredibly important because I know that you'll set the stage for a confident and a safe return for students on Tuesday. And we have incredibly dedicated, hardworking, and skilled professional teachers and EAs and others in the healthcare system who step up to a challenge because they want what's best for the students that they're entrusted with. And I know that this will be no different, even though they're back a little bit earlier than might have been anticipated many months ago. They're, of course, applying that with their professional dedication, as they always, always do. So we look forward to next Tuesday welcoming students back, as I now look forward to your questions.
Minister, can you explain why Brandon and Prairie Mountain schools are yellow and the region's orange?
So the coding system that's been developed by the province of Manitoba, BARD, are triggers that are used by public health. And so public health makes the determination in terms of areas or individual institutions. So, for example, in my community, the Bethesda place is or was under a red classification because of the unique circumstance there. The entire community, however, wasn't. My understanding from public health is they've made the determination that because of special provisions and protocols that are happening within schools, that it is safe for them to be at a yellow.
Daily release of statistics about the number of students, teachers, or other people in schools who are diagnosed with COVID-19.
So I think that what public health has indicated is that they intend within the daily press releases that they put out to indicate, information where there's been positive cases in schools, and I think, you know, where there's been an infectious period within the schools. We have to remember that every time a student, possibly is confirmed for having COVID-19, that doesn't mean that they got it in the school or that they ever were in the school, right? Particularly when I think of high school students, they're out into the community all the time. There's never a sense that, you know, they've been at home for the last many months, and now that school is starting, now they're off into school, leaving their homes. They've been in the community for many months doing what young people do, working at jobs and interacting more broadly in society. So they're, you know, I think the public health will look at, as they always do, when there's a confirmed case, where did the case come from? Who are those close contacts? Is there a vulnerability within a school or a cohort? And then make those pronouncements.
And you mentioned the anxiety that parents are facing leading up to this. There's less than a week to go. And there's some voice and frustrations that this information is just being released now. What's your response to that, and why release these details in a package format now?
So I think part of it is, you know, you release the information when it's best able to be released. There's no question that everyone in a situation like this, in the pandemic more generally, right from when this sort of hit our radars in late February or March, everybody wanted information on everything as quickly as it could be provided, which is natural and understandable. But providing quick information isn't always providing good information. And so we needed to work through protocols with public health. Those are where those protocols, primarily when it comes to safety for students in schools, are coming from, how the responses will be, how public health will notify schools and officials. Those had to be worked through, and they had to be worked through well. So I would much prefer, would I have preferred to have this document out a month ago? Sure, but not in a form that wasn't as clear and as good as it could be. So I'd much prefer to have a very good document out a week before a poor document a month prior.
Minister Goertzen, you mentioned you are getting a lot of questions from parents who are concerned. What are some of those key questions that kind of keep coming up?
Well, look, I mean, here's the interesting thing, right, is that a pandemic clearly proves to be divisive, and it divides people. And so I get lots of emails and messages in various forms. Sometimes people think it might all be kind of the same thing. Well, we'd like more of this or less of that. But there's a lot of division. And so I do hear from a lot of parents who say, well, we're concerned about going back to school and what that's going to look like for our children. That's clear across the country that those concerns, regardless of the plans of any province, of any government, of any political stripe, those are common concerns about whether there's enough. And then I get many concerns each and every day that says there's too much being done, and we're worried about our children going back into an artificial environment, and we don't like the mask mandate. So there are concerns that happen on both sides of these issues. They're significant. They're all emotional. But whether I'm reading a stack of emails that says, you know, we'd like to see far more done on this particular issue because we're concerned, or a stack of emails that says there's way too much being done and this is going to harm children because we think it's going to hurt them, you know, psychologically, and you need to, you know, stop trying to scare children. Well, those are both important because they're coming from Manitobans and they're expressing their views. We rely on the public health advice, quite apart from the emotion. We have to rely on the public health advice. That has to be what drives this, not, you know, the various concerns that exist on one side or the other, because they can't be resolved. The reality is that of all the different concerns that we're getting, you can't take all those concerns between too much is being done and too little is being done and try to resolve them. What you can do is what you should do in a pandemic, and that's listen to health experts in Manitoba who are driven by the Manitoba context.
some parents haven't made decisions about what they're going to do next week with only a few days left. You know, they're holding out for a remote learning option. They're waiting to find out if their child or if their family applies or will qualify to have that remote learning option. As the options stand right now, I know you've mentioned this before, homeschooling, remote learning, if you do have an immunocompromised student, or in person, is that set in stone right now?
So those are the options as they exist. I would say that, yes, we have an at-home learning stream for those who are immune compromised and for those who have other medical conditions where it's been documented and verified. But we've always said, and we said it back in June, that school divisions need to prepare for other at-home learning scenarios, right? If we were in different sort of codes, we didn't have the coloring system back then, but if we were in different situations in the pandemic, that we would need to have different responses. So they have been working up robust at-home learning systems and possibilities and ways to enact that if the environment changes. So we'll continually, as Dr. Roosen says, monitor that environment, continue to rely on advice of public health. So that is to say, and why I say it is that, yes, those are the options now, but if we are required to change because the circumstances change, it's not like they'd be building a remote home learning option from zero. It wouldn't be like March. They've already done all of that work and all of that planning.
Why is remote learning not an option for everyone?
So obviously one of the challenges that we've had, and we work with our partners in education in this, is that there are challenges in terms of ensuring, well, first of all, the best place for a child to learn is in the classroom. That is repeated by all of the different experts. We saw the impact of not having children in classroom in March. There's a lot of impact that are well beyond education. So you start from the de facto position that the best place for a child to learn is in the classroom. But then there's other issues that occur, right? I mean, if you're going to have students at home, you need to have, if they're not in a homeschooling environment, you need to have teachers there that are supporting them as well. And many teachers told us, so it's very, very difficult for them to do that dual sort of track where they were teaching part of their class at home, part of their class within the class. And so that's been a reality that we've heard from the Manitoba Teacher Society as well. So there's a variety of different issues. There's practical considerations, but then there's also the reality that it is the best place for students to learn in the classroom. And when you're guided by public health and the best medical advice and experts in Manitoba say that this is a safe way to return students to school, then you want to return them to school.
Have you received any indication how many parents are going to keep their students home, whether it is through homeschooling or remote learning?
So not directly. It would be, well, wouldn't all be anecdotal. So within the department, we have a homeschooling division or a branch, and parents have to register if they're interested in homeschooling. So last year, I believe there was 3,800 or so students who had homeschooled. As of Friday of last week, I think I was told this morning that 1,500 or 1,600 had registered. So, you know, less than half of last year, but don't take that as an indication of what might come. Many people register near the end. I think maybe to Maggie's point, you know, people might be waiting to see, you know, how they feel or what happens. So we're not expecting those numbers to be less than last year, but it doesn't look like it's a tsunami either.
If a family chooses to pick homeschooling, let's say sometime this month, do they have the option to come back into the public system in October, if they, you know, see things are working out? What is that?
It's always been the option with homeschooling. And so parents who begin to homeschool their child, my understanding is that they for whatever reason and circumstances change in parents' life, that they are not able to homeschool anymore, or it's not working out for them, then a school division in their catchment area has to provide them an ability to come back into the system.
There is a change, and I don't know if this is a typo or a specific policy change. Instead of the 1 meter between desks, it's been removed to just space in this document. What's up with that?
My understanding is that, you know, when you're not able to achieve the 2 meters and so you're cohorting individuals, that it was 1 meter that they're considering the standard.
So the removal of the 1 meter from these documents is...
I understood that was still the standard. I can get back to you on that.
Okay. Mr. Goertzen, a slightly different topic, but can you talk a little bit about protocols that are in place for breakfast programs, and if a breakfast program can't abide by those protocols, what options are available, whether it's because of cost or the guidelines? What happens then?
So, I mean, there's a number of questions that come around, breakfast programs. I know that school divisions who primarily run their own breakfast programs have been working closely with the guidelines, have even through the summer been providing support. There was a provincial initiative as well that was providing food, a new initiative during this break where parents or families could pick up food. So there's a number of different options that exist. They may look different throughout the year, but I think that there is a commitment from everyone in government, whether that's through the school divisions or through the province itself, to ensure that that happens.
Was there any real consideration to delaying the start of the school year further, especially as we're seeing more cases pop up in Winnipeg and Brandon and in other districts as well?
So it wasn't off the table, right? But it would have had been advice that we were getting from public health. So public health would have said that for some reason they feel that the situation has changed in a way that the plan needs to change in a way, then that's advice that would have been followed. But that hasn't been the indication. But it wasn't as though there was some hard and fast determination that we wouldn't, but it always has to be driven by what are the facts. Maggie?
Or teachers, rather, are planning how their desks are going to be split up. So you're going back to Bart's point about the 1 meter. Is it 1 meter between the ends of the desks or between students?
I believe that the has to be 1 meter between students, but we can get you those details.
What exists, really.
Like that in a current classroom that students are 1 meters apart?
Student to student, pre-pandemic, yeah. I mean, that's about the same as pre-pandemic. That is the same as pre-pandemic distance.
Well, I think one of the differences, though, is, when you're cohorting individuals, that's done for particular health reasons. The 1 meter requirement, the standard, is one the public health said, if you're cohorting, is a reasonable standard.
With just the status of teachers as essential workers, I noticed that in the document with the response levels in red, if schools are pretty much going to have to shutter, then those essential service workers will, including teachers, will be able to have their students in school still. Does that mean that teachers are now deemed essential service workers?
Well, teachers have special status, already in terms of their inability to strike, right? And so they have binding arbitration provisions already. So there are different definitions, I guess, of essential workers, or essential workers as they exist within particular provincial legislation, or those that have sometimes been deemed that within a pandemic environment. So we would be requiring the level of teachers we need to be back in classrooms. Of course, we're hoping we don't get there. I don't think that, we're hoping we don't get there.
Are we calling teachers essential service workers now?
I think when we get to that perspective, if they want to classify certain groups of workers, again, where we're into a lockdown or a more restricted situation, then there'd be identification of individuals and workers who would be identified as essential as they were before. But that's different than a statutory definition of an essential worker when it comes to the ability to strike, for example.
My understanding from these papers is that parents will be notified if their child was in a classroom or in a cohort with an infectious student who had COVID-19 and was in school when they were infectious. Does this mean that, and if parents don't get a notification, then there's no concern to their child, but will parents be notified? Will they get information if there is a COVID case in the school, even if it's not putting their child at risk? Will that still be communicated?
So Dr. Rustin, I think, will answer some of the questions in terms of that kind of notification. I think that they've made it clear that they want to provide information that is helpful and that is important for students and parents to get. So clearly when somebody is identified as having COVID-19, they'll do the contact tracing. I understand they'll be able to do it within 24 hours, as is their standard. They would then make contact with those who that individual has had contact with if they found that they had not been infectious during that time in the schools. Then they may not notify the schools because there wouldn't be a particular reason to. But if they were infectious in the school, then they would notify those who they believe they had close contact with, which in some cases might be their entire cohort if they're cohorted, but in some cases not. And hopefully in most cases not, because the intention isn't to shut down a cohort or a portion of a school every time that there is a positive case that is found. And then they would notify the administrators of the school to make the determination of a broader notice. My belief is that we should be providing, you know, as much information as we can when it comes to particular schools where there has been instances, because we know what will happen otherwise, right? I mean, you're going to, if we do it in a broad-based region, and you use Southern, for example, and this won't happen, but if you use Southern, you said, well, there was a, you know, an outbreak in a school in Southern, well, that's a pretty big area, and maybe it happened in Steinbeck, maybe it happened in Portage, maybe it happened in Winkler, but those are all great communities, but not all that close together, actually. And so I think that my hope is that it's identified more distinctly within the news releases that go out weekly or daily, sorry.
So that hasn't been decided yet whether or not parents will be notified if there's been COVID-19 positive cases in their school.
If there's a reason medically that they be notified, they would absolutely be notified. And the school administrators would be notified, and they would be providing information then to the broader school community that they felt should be provided. But I would like to see more transparency in terms of schools, because I think it will provide less. I think it'll provide more confidence and less.
Yeah, I mean, given how zealous parents can get, and I'm using that term mildly.
Zealous is a mild term, no matter how you use it, Bart. But you can try again.
given how like anxious and kind of quirky parents can get, when I hear you say, and you said you would like to see as much transparency as possible, if there isn't like broad disclosure, parents might rumor mongering the kinds of stigma, everything that you've been talking about. What are you going to do to nip that kind of stuff in the bud if it's decided, well, this isn't a medical reason for notifying you about...
So I've given you, I give my feeling on disclosure about it, but Dr. Rustin, I'm sure, will speak more specifically about how he feels some of the disclosure should happen.
Thank you, Minister. We're going to go to the telephone now. First up from City News, Stephanie.
Hi, Minister. Stephanie will speak with City News. Just wondering if you can, I guess you said that you would like to see, you know, more clarity given, but I guess parents want to know how much clarity will actually be given. I know you said it's kind of up to Dr. Rustin as well. I just want to know, I guess, how much will actually be given to parents.
I think that it's incumbent upon us to provide enough information that not only meets the medical need, but also meets the emotional needs of parents who are in a school. I know as a parent, because here's the reality, as a parent, I'm going to hear what's happening in the school. We're all connected to other parents. And so we're going to hear about things. And so while that's, you know, informative in one way, it's not particularly assuring. And so my view is that it should be provided in a way that both assures parents from a medical perspective, but also those around that might not be anywhere close to where there was an outbreak. But you can speak to Dr. Rustin specifically about that tomorrow in terms of notification, because notification will come from public health.
Okay, And what plans are currently in place if a teacher needs to go into maybe self-isolation or a teacher gets sick? I know there's extra money there for extra teachers, but what plans are currently in place to kind of enforce that right away so that there is no missed days of learning?
So the school divisions have done really good work in terms of building up their own human resources. They recognize this is going to be a difficult year and there's going to be more absentees, both from a student perspective, but then also from a teacher perspective. So we've also been working to ensure that there are other opportunities, whether it's retired teachers or EAs or those who are in the Faculty of Education, to have more ability to come into the schools and provide learning or supervised opportunities where there are either teachers who have to leave during the day or where we just find out in the morning or school just finds out in the morning or it's a longer term absence. So it is going to be a challenge. We've been saying that for months now, that both busing and human resources are going to be a challenge. I think both of those are going to be true. But there's been good work done in terms of trying to expand the net in terms of those who can be providing that instruction or supervision within the class where an unexpected or a long-term situation happens where a teacher is out of the classroom.
From the Brandon Sun, Colin.
Hi, Minister. Colin from the Brandon Sun here. I was wondering if there already having been a little confusion over all sorts of different entities in Brandon being under different color conditions in the pandemic response system. What will the government and school divisions be expected to do to inform parents if there is any change at a school or school division level?
Yeah, so thanks for that. And no, I recognize that there's been some confusion when it comes to the different color coding in which state either an area is under separate from a school. And sort of as mentioned before, you can have situations where certain parts of a region are under a different alert level. So as I mentioned before, a PCH within my own community that I live in might be under red, but the entire city is still under yellow. So those aren't contradictory. They are just different environments that they're trying to manage. And so public health sees the school environment as different in terms of than the broader community environment. They felt that it was appropriate to keep the school environment in Brandon still under yellow. In terms of communication, though, you're absolutely right. If there is a change in one form or another in terms of what code a school or a division might be under, that information would go directly to the parents and obviously as quickly as possible. But there'd obviously be in a situation like that if you're talking about moving from a broad color coding on one area to another, there'd be a much broader public communications as well.
But will they get phone calls? Will they get emails? Like, how will parents be? How will parents be reached out to?
So in the best way that they've determined that they want to be contacted with. So already now, schools and school divisions connect with parents in the way that they've been provided the parents' information. So over the summer, for example, a number of the school divisions will have had contacts, a great deal of contacts with parents to ask them things like, can you bring your child to school, for example, because we might have some challenges with busing. And they will have been contacting them in the way that parents have indicated is the best way to be contacted with.
From CBC Radio Canada, Laisa.
No question.
From CTV Winnipeg, John.
Hello, Minister. John Hendricks from CTV. Based on your previous answer, my understanding of why you won't allow parents to choose remote learning is because you're concerned about the burden on teachers. But aren't they already, in essence, going to be providing some remote learning options for students anyway, for those who are compromised, for those who are required to self-isolate. So what would be the burden then of offering it as an option for all parents?
Yeah, thanks, John, for the question. Again, the primary consideration is that it is believed, and I think it's believed by teachers and others, that the best learning environment for the majority of students is in the classroom. And so that's sort of the default position. It's the position that we saw in March. We saw lots of negative implications of students not being in class in the spring, a lot of them that had to do with education outcomes, and a lot of them that didn't have to do specifically with education outcomes. So the default position, the starting position, is that it is best for students to be in the classroom where it is safe. And then we move to the guidance from public health in developing this back-to-school plan, where the determination from them, together with health measures that have been put in place through their advice, is that it is safe for students to go back to school. Then you step one step out and go, but there are certain students for whom it might not be the best place to be because they are immune compromised or other medical conditions. And so then you ensure that there is an ability for the school divisions to provide that. So those are the starting points. But then when you go much more broadly than that, if you're going to have significant higher scale of students who are not in the classroom and but are looking for that teacher-led learning, then that is an entirely different challenge and problem. In fact, if you just even go back to June, where we were looking to have the schools open on a more limited basis, and ultimately we did have them open on a limited basis fairly successfully. Only us, BC and Quebec, I believe, reopened schools in some fashion in the June. Still, the greatest concern that we had, and we heard the questions from media here, on behalf of teachers who are asking the questions, is, well, how do you expect teachers to do both have at-home learning and now some in-class learning? So that has always been a concern from teachers all through this process.
Thank you. My other question is, has the province received or sought out any legal opinion as to whether or not the school divisions or the province itself would be legally liable should a child or teacher contract COVID-19?
I've not seen a legal opinion, nor have I asked for a legal opinion on that.
From CBC, Cameron.
Hi, Minister. My question is about homeschooling. We've had some parents ask if multiple children can attend a homeschool at the same location. Is that possible, and what regulations would apply if so?
So thanks, Cameron. I'm not an expert on homeschooling. I've not homeschooled my own children. I do know that there are homeschooling groups, so that there are groups of children from different families who are homeschooled together. That's not an unusual thing. I don't believe in Manitoba that's the way some parents have structured it. But obviously, they would have to follow whatever health guidelines that exist, and to ensure that they're not violating whether it's gathering sizes or the various health provisions that exist. I can provide you some of the specific policy provisions around homeschooling if you like, but I believe that there are a number of homeschooling families who do exactly that, where it's not just their own child that are being homeschooled.
Thanks. And another follow-up question. If a parent chooses to homeschool their kid for, say, the start of the year and then decides they want them to go back, there's nothing preventing them doing so if they want to send their child to school within their home school district. Is that correct?
That's correct. The home school district has to allow them to be back within the school system if they choose. Because as you can imagine, there's lots of scenarios that can happen within a family that can change that dynamic.
Thank you, Minister. We now go back to room 68.
Minister, just more on this one meter business. My colleagues have been inside a school where the desks are actually, the desks, not even the students, are less than a meter apart. What's the province doing to police that?
So we have, you know, made it clear to the different schools and school divisions that, as we announced back in June, that we put out the overall parameters of what needs to be achieved. And then they started work on their individual division plans and ultimately their individual school plans. And those school plans have then been communicated out to parents who have students within those individual schools. We have daily conversations with representatives of the various stakeholders, whether that's Manitoba Teachers Society, the school trustees, Federation of Independent Schools, superintendents. They're all well aware of the requirements and the public health requirements. I believe that they're all doing, you know, really hard but really, you know, good work in trying to ensure that they're meeting all of those. And as we continue to have those discussions with them, if they are having challenges with that, if they have challenges with busing, and there's been challenges with busing, and they've come back and they've raised those concerns to us, then we do our best to work through those challenges with public health. So if there are instances where those public health provisions are not being met, I would expect that they'd be reported from the officials, because if not, I'm sure that we'd be hearing them in other ways from concerned parents or otherwise.
Will you be, or when will you be publishing a more detailed list of medical conditions that may allow students to not wear masks?
So I think that it's discussed somewhat in the documents that are provided here, and the advice, I believe, is that, you know, parents should speak to their family physician, or a student should be speaking to their family physician if they feel that they're unable to wear a mask. Those circumstances are probably relatively few, but I'm not a medical doctor, so I won't presume that. And they should have that discussion with their doctors, and then the parents can document that for the schools if their child is unable to wear a mask.
Okay, we have time for one or two more.
When it comes to students potentially, you know, breaking a social distancing rule, you know, sort of bullying, is there a protocol for how schools should handle that when it comes to either penalties or restorative justice or any kind of approach?
Well, I mean, they're a little different, right? I mean, if there's a 1 meter that's, or sorry, 2 meters that's breached on the physical distancing, you know, I would say handle it in the way that Manitobans handle things, and that's sort of reasonably. I mean, I do believe that more than 95% of Manitobans are doing their absolute best to try to follow health provisions and health protocols. But, you know, sometimes people make mistakes, and I've made some of those mistakes too. And I think you've documented some of those mistakes, and you'll continue to document them, and that's fine. But there are mistakes that get made. But I don't think it's generally because it's purposeful. So I think where that happens, then school officials or teachers will, you know, sort of gently remind students, you know, to, oh, they were looking for that 2 meters distance, and they'll do it reasonably and respectfully, as I think people should expect. When it comes to bullying, now that's something different, and if that is going to be, you know, that might result in punishment, as bullying always should. You know, we have to be mindful of the fact that people are in different circumstances and different life realities, and yes, as Bart says, there's going to be some students who aren't wearing masks for whatever reasons that they have that have been documented, but we don't know what those reasons are, and so we should be respectful of them in the same way for other students who are wearing masks, and we need to be respectful on all sides. I mean, it doesn't take that much to be respectful of each other. Yeah, it's stressful. Yes, there's anxiety. I get all of that. I have all of that. But that doesn't mean we can't be respectful to each other.
I'm kind of adding on to that point. There's a new report that came out that shows the kind of the toll COVID-19 has taken on children, basically in terms of mental illness, poverty, that sort of thing, basically making a bad situation worse. What supports are in place in Manitoba schools to help children that are maybe really struggling more than others because of COVID-19, whether it's anxiety or mental illness issues?
So the study shows a couple of things, right? It absolutely shows the anxiety and the mental health challenges that students, and probably not just students, society as a whole, I'm sure, are facing. But then it also shows the impact of what happened when schools weren't open in the spring. And so what did that do to you know, food insecurity? And what did that do to, you know, children who were relying on things in schools for other things? So yes, it speaks to the need for many students to be back in school. They relied on that school environment for a lot of things that had more to do than just education. So the impact of having schools closed, which speaks to the importance of having our schools open in a safe way. And then the resources that exist within schools, and there are multitudes of them and multitude of programs. They may have to be delivered in a bit of a different way because we may not have as many people coming into the school from the outside as we did before, but they also have to be flexible. So whether we've been talking to providers from the True North Youth Foundation, or Sheldon Kennedy's group, or the wraparound services that exist with psychiatric nurses. I mean, those are all things that may have to be adapted as we go along, because we almost know for sure. I hate to say that anything's for sure these days, but we almost know for sure there's going to be impact on students from a mental health perspective. I don't know that we quite understand the depth of that or what that actually results in. So there's going to be a lot of watching, observing, and then changing, I think, as we go along with some of the programs.
Is there going to be funding for those extra programs that may be needed or to adjust those programs? Or is that going to be expected to come out of the $100 million pot that was set aside?
So, I mean, we've announced, as you mentioned, the $100 million, which is being accessed in a lot of different ways, but we've set school divisions all along, we speak with them daily through their associations, and we will continue as we go into the opening, that we need to find out, you know, what are the different challenges you're facing. So some of that might be mental health, some of that will be human resources, some of that will continue to be busing, and then we want to be there to support those needs as best we can, right? The right approach, though, is to not say, here's X amount of hundreds of millions of dollars, now everybody sort of reach in and take what you'd like. The right approach is, what are your needs? And then let's assign resources to meet those needs.
Okay, I think we'll wrap it up there. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you very much, Minister.
Thank you all. Have a great rest of the day and remainder of the week.
If you don't want, is that 1 meter thing just a typo drop or policy change? I'm not...